The other day, on the radio, they asked a very nice question, which I think I should handle first. And the question was, what is the difference between other sects and Sahaja Yoga? It's a very good question because it gives you a relative idea as to what is reality and what is not. First of all, we should see what is the need of Sahaja Yoga. Sahaja, as you know, is Saha means with, Ja means born. Is born with you, means is spontaneous. It is with you. What is with you is the right to be united with the Divine. That is, to be in yoga, to be united with God. Now there are people who just don't believe in God either. It's quite possible. They are frightened to hear the name of God because of various experiences they have had, the various ideologies that have prevailed. But God exists, no doubt, whether you like it or not. But unless and until you have felt the existence of God, to believe in God is difficult. One can understand that. Now, what is Sahaja Yoga? In Sahaja Yoga, what actually happens to a personality is this, that the sleeping power, or we can say unawakened power within you, which is your germinating power, arises, passes through the various subtle centers within you and pierces through this fontanelle area and what we call it as a baptism, as a blessing or the grace of the Holy Ghost, you get your realization. It's a happening. It's actualization. It is living. It is living. It is the blessing of the living God, not of an artificial one. Like anybody calling you, say, all right, let me baptize you, and just puts your hand, their hand on the head. It may not be baptism at all, because how can he? Because he has not raised your kundalini. It's like any seed, supposing we have. And the seed, we say that this seed is living. All right, how do you prove it? Unless and until you germinate it, how can you prove that it's a living thing? So the germination has to take place. Unless and until that happens, how can people believe in anything, whatever you may call it? So this rebirth has to take place, as everybody has told. Now we need not sort of deny all that, defy all that, but we can keep ourselves open to understand what is the thing they are talking about. Now why? What is the need? What is the need for a person to get his realization? That's the main thing. First of all, people have said, you are the spirit. All right, we may be. So why? What is the need to be the spirit? We are all right as human beings, as flesh, everything. What is the need to be realized? And once you understand the need, then you'll understand what is Sahaja Yoga and what are other sects are. The need is this, that you are a part and parcel of the whole. Like a big primordial being you can think of, and he has many cells, and you are one of the cells. But you are not aware of it. You are not yet collective. Now the difference between collective and a mass system is different. In a mass system, I mean, you can hypnotize complete mass, they'll start dancing, jumping, screaming, shouting. You can do what you like to masses. I mean, if the masses are of a weak-minded thing, you can ask them to commit suicide. You can tell them anything they will do if you just want to use the mass media. Like they become hysteric. Actually, it is a special thing within us which makes you mimic others. Is a very ancient thing within us, very, very ancient, that we were, as animals, we used to do that. See, you have seen birds. Have you ever seen the birds like cranes flying out? They always go in a triangular way. And as the one, the leader turns, all the rest of them follow it very automatically. So that's this instinct we had to follow others, you see, to copy others. That's a very deep training to our being that we try to follow others. And that's why what happens, we see some people going somewhere, so we think, oh, we should also do the same thing. It's that competition between us. See, this competitiveness has also come from the same seed within us of copying others. You see, we try to copy others. Like clubbing now, we have a club, say, club of people who dress up like white suits and things, and there are clubs with the certain type of dress, or you can find, as I last time told you, yards and yards of black suitings. You see, walking in elite societies. I mean, it's just clubbing, you know. You just want to club it together, put it together. Then uniforms are there, and then you have to wear the uniforms, and you sort of feel that you are a part of the mass. It's a part of the mass now. Again, this is a mass thing. But Sahaja Yoga is a collective thing. People talk of collectivity. All of them talk of collectivity. But it is only rational. It is artificial. For example, a husband and wife must live together happily. Now the reason for that they give is that if they don't live happily, this will happen to children, that will happen to children, that will happen, and that it may be that it won't be good for both of them. So we reason it out, go to a point, a rational point, we call it a logical point, where we say, all right, we should not give up the relationship between husband and wife. But supposing husband and wife get realized, then what happens? They become aware of their duty as parents, aware. Awareness is a very different thing from just be in mass. Like husband wife feel that, you see, marriage is not thinking, but you just feel it within yourself, not as a feeling of emotional style, but actually it becomes your being. For example, after realization you start feeling the cool breeze in the heart. But supposing the husband and wife are trying to deceive each other, immediately the vibrations will go. There will be no cool breeze. It's finished. They cannot proceed more further with it. Supposing a person has bad habits, say some dirty habits he has developed in his childhood and is continuing with it. After realization, if he starts indulging into it, immediately he finds he's feeling uneasy and his vibrations are. He becomes aware, he's on his central nervous system, he can feel the bad effects of what we call as bad. He feels burning, he feels different centers are in trouble. I mean, he can feel it just like as you can feel it hot and cold on your fingers. So when you become aware, then real collectivity can come. It is not a rational thing to say, oh, we are interdependent and we have to help each other. We must do this in a way that nobody should be harmed, that we should not be harmed, and all this rationality is not in it. For supposing tomorrow, if somebody tries to put a pin through, immediately the other hand will go there and hit the person and this hand will go. All the body will react automatically. The whole body will react to aggression on one side or any kind of problem. But it is aware. It is not doing with rationality, there is no, it is spontaneous. There is no question of anybody thinking about it, but it happens spontaneously. So to preserve ourselves, to preserve our body, mind, everything is a disintegrated action before realization. For example, before realization, the brain will say, all right, you do like this. But the heart will say no. For example, supposing a man falls in love with a man. So the heart says, oh, it's carry on, she's a nice lady. Brain says, oh, it's not problems, it's disturbing her family life, is not a good thing. The dharma, the religious part in the stomach, which is also a reality. It is not the dharma we talk of in the church or anything. The gentleman can come here and pick a seat. Hey, God.
So that can be done, and but the realized person does everything in an integrated, like if he in love with a married lady, immediately he cannot follow. He cannot fall in love with a married lady. Just doesn't do it. No question of them saying he does not have expectation. You just don't do that. You just don't like it. Because you become aware, and the awareness is not rational at all. We cannot think of awareness which is right, not rational. Because whatever is not rational, according to us, it's a nonsense. It's erratical, it's arbitrary, it's nonsense. But it is a sense that develops within you. It's an actual sense within you that develops. Not the way it is developed with thinking, the sense with your mind, but the sense in your organs, in your body, in your being, in your heart, that you just do. This is awareness and this is collectivity. And those who cannot rise to collectivity cannot be good surgeons. And once you understand that this comes through the awakening of your spirit, then you understand all the problems of the world can only be solved if human beings become that collective being. That collective being is a spirit. And this collective being, if it is somehow awakened in our attention, then we automatically become collectively conscious. We don't have to rationalize it, just that. Me, a little child, will immediately say, oh, mother, see, this man has got problems. How do you do? Oh, all my fingers are burning. That person is not denounced because he is not well, whatever may be the problem. That person is not discarded, nor is told that he is good for nothing. But immediately you feel the problem as a witness of that person. And you have a power because you are collectively conscious. As you can correct within yourself, you can correct others also because you are collectively conscious. Means you have the power to correct another person, to relieve him of the pain, trouble, to help him out, to cure him, to do whatever is needed, just by yourself. Because at the point where you are, at the spirit point, you are one with the spirit. I would say, like, while I'm talking to you, I'm only connected with this spirit. But supposing I was on a radio station, then I'm connected. That point of connection is the spirit. And unless until you have achieved that point of connection, the rest of all your doings are good for nothing. Now what is the difference between a spirit and Sahaja Yoga? In Sahaja Yoga, an individual, again, we are all individuals before realization. The other day, as I told you, Minister, we are all like eggs. And that's the sign of a human being, that is still an egg. He lives in a shell, he thinks of himself, he thinks of his family, it's good in a way, he thinks of his country, everything good up to that point. Because he's a shell. Whatever he tries to make himself big, it's United Nations, everything you do. But that shell business will remain in you. It will be there showing results. But when you get that shell broken completely in you, are a bird, you just fly. So the day of resurrection, as I said, the day of resurrection has come. It's mentioned in the Quran many a times, much more times than about the day of doom. This is the day of resurrection, where people have to be resurrected to be their spirits, as Christ himself has done that for us by crossing the gates of our catcher. Now this is not except because there is nothing unreal about it. Nothing unreal. There's no hypnosis. Nothing. You are completely aware of what you are doing. You are aware that there is your power within yourself. And that power is unique. And that you become that power. But that power is not of domination or overpowering anybody, but of love. But of love of God, which is doing each and every work of this world. For these flowers have come out from that. These flowers become fruit because of that. Because of that power, people conceive children. Because of that you are born. Because of that power, you have become from amoeba to this. So that instinct of the mass is very much now prevalent and used in these cells. They just give a mass feeling to people that, you see, a competition is set in. First of all, in all these Western cities especially, people are conscious of their money power. So they use that also. So you pay some money. Like on a horse, you pay a certain amount, they pay for a set. So much money I'll pay. The other says, have you paid so much? I mean, you'll be surprised, in the elite societies they talk like that. Oh, these days, you know, I'm having so much of money and I want to go and join a set, this set or that set or that set. Because the competition is set. Anyway, you see these musicians and singers when they sing. Actually, it was all manual. It was all manual in the beginning, that they get hold of some people who are weak-minded, who do not know their real power. So, to overpower them and use that instinct, that subconscious instinct in them, to excite them. And once they are excited, they all go mad. All go mad. And they become. And that hysteria is used to be out and out by all the things. And that's why people are so crazy. If you look at them, you can't believe they're anywhere near God. How can they be? They all look crazy, possessed, mad. But this collectivity is to be understood in its all dimensions in Sahaja Yoga. This is the second task of Sahaja Yoga, which is more difficult than the first one. To give realization is not a point of view. Because it's a natural thing, it is within you, the time has come, the block of time is there, you get realization but not without much difficulty. If not in one sitting, in second sitting you get it, no doubt. But to establish you as a collective self of the whole is a very difficult thing. And unless and until you are that, you are thrown out of the room. If you don't become aware of it, you are just thrown out. Now, collectivity in Sahaja Yoga does not mean that you wear some kind of dresses, all of you wearing the same kind of dresses, or doing the same type of thing, or jumping, or any such thing which has no sensible logic. It is the collectivity that you feel within yourself, that nearness you feel, not emotional. Also, I would say, people think it's an emotional attachment to this. It's not emotionless, it is beyond emotions, it is beyond thought, it is the spirit. Because everybody has got the spirit in them. Only thing you have to become the spirit. Now, anything you see, even we can say, going to a temple. Now, in India, ladies are busy dressing up if they have to go to temple. They'll find out what sari she's wearing, what sari am I going to wear. Like we do it in the churches also. We go there with our best dresses, just watching what dress she has worn. Then we come out of the church, they directly ask the question, where did you get this one, you see. So the whole attention is on a social contact, a social mass feeling within ourselves. So we are not individuals at all at that time, not at all. First we have to be absolutely individuals. And then you become a complete, aware part of the whole. If you are not an individual, say that's why people who belong to this sect or belong to some sort of a commitment or to an organized place, they find it difficult. Because they are not yet prepared to accept that individual jump into the whole. If the whole of it comes, well and if the whole doesn't come, they are sticking on to it. Though it can be very superficial also. Like you see, in England it is a custom to put the fork and spoon in a particular way. In France it is different. In somewhere it is different. Now even that can be a club form itself for us. Because you see, we are Americans, we put it this way. We are English, we put it this way. If you are French, we put it this way. But it is such a superficial sort of a thing. And if you go into it, it's all superficial. All our clubbing is superficial. Now, if you start getting after it and reacting against it, then you are destroying yourself. You are completely destroyed. There is no need to destroy anything else. But you will understand that this is superficial. Nothing, you should not waste your energy in fighting anyone. There is no need to fight anything to get out. There is no need to fight any such thing. What happens that by fighting, you lose your energy for nothing at all. On the contrary, you should understand that all these things are artificial and you should wait for a moment when you get the reality. But if you fight them also, that's a problem. If you don't fight them and you become one, that's a problem. So both things are energy sampling. We go on thinking about it. Where do we reach? We reach nowhere. So, Sahaja Yoga is a system which is a system of the nature. It is not a system of human beings which is artificial or an organization or a mass movement, nothing. It is the system of the nature itself which has made you a human being, an individual, now like an egg. Now, this individual has to become not the mass, which is an animal state, but to become collectively conscious, has to become, is a consciousness. Means on the central nervous system, you feel that consciousness. And that is what is the reality. We go about into anything, understanding that this is right, that is right, is all meant. If you understand everything, whatever is mentally available, you are still in the shell. But what you feel is the point. What you feel on your central nervous system is your real consciousness. The rest of it is your mental activity, the imagination, and whatever is mental is imagined. It has no meaning. Like we have written books after books, I don't know how many energies have been wasted in doing all sorts of things, books after books that have written about this, that, all kinds of yarns and yarns of, I should say, imaginary wanderings about things. But that's not the thing, you see. It's within yourself. That's within yourself. It's your own spirit resides there in your heart. It's your own power which you should. And if you can feel that power, then you will be amazed that you don't have to have any United Nations organization and all that. You really enter into the kingdom of God in the sense that you get that power of love which makes you extremely loving, sweet, I should say magnetic, extremely gentle, and also could be very powerful if it comes to use of power. It's extremely powerful. In your behavior, you become an extremely attractive person in the sense that you do not give trouble to others. You do not, on the contrary, you are a troubleshooter, I should say. You are a person who is a peacemaker. Wherever you stand, you create peace and happiness. But this is still up inside you, so tranquil and peaceful. And the highest of all is that you are so connected that even verbally, if you ask any question, is there God? You start getting great vibration. The rapport is established. You can see that the rapport is now established. You can talk to God. It's easy to say that there is no God. It's very good because then we have no headaches, people think. But all the headaches come because of this kind of a belief also that there is no God. And also there will be headaches if you believe that there is God without knowing. Both things, according to me, are still the two sides of a pendulum, which is not in the center. Or we can say, this is how we go to the right and to the left, but do not ascend. For the ascent, this actual thing, this living thing, this germination, has to be. And that is why Sahaja Yoga transcends all this nonsense. Absolutely. It has no respect for it. It has no respect because it saps the energy of human being. It puts them down. It doesn't give them chance to rise to their own power which is within them. But with understanding that after all human beings are ignorant about it, they are not very sure. It's all right if they are involved with any other such things, doesn't matter. But in a sense, if you go, I'm surprised I went to a Unity Church, imagine, Unity Church. Any poster, they were kind enough to invite me there. They didn't know how outspoken I was about things, you see. Poor things were in trouble, I think, after my coming. But whatever the case, I was surprised. They were saying all kinds of books there, all kinds, which are satanic, which are mass movements, which are very detrimental to human beings. And they knew them. Like in a church, they were selling books of a man who is teaching licentiousness, permissiveness. Can you imagine? Such contradictory things. I mean, either Christ was wrong or this man was wrong. How can you have both the things together? And they were saying, this is unity. This is not unity. This is not unity. This is such a superficial unity of getting all the dust, filth, everything together and gold with it and say, now you have it. Do you put in your food the poison and then eat it because you want to unite it? You can only unite it which can be united. You cannot unite all the mess of the world together and say, this is unity. You cannot unite Christ with a man who is teaching licentiousness, permissiveness and all kinds of dirty tricks. So one has to understand, the mind is a very tricky, that the mind itself is a very, very tricky thing. It's a very intelligent thing, it beats you there. And you start with this kind of, oh, let it be, doesn't matter, you start compromise. How can there be compromise between the food and the poison when you have to stick in the food, simple thing like that? We have to separate. We have to say, this is wrong. Whether people like it or not, if we have to respect human life, if you have to respect this great creation of God, if you have to see that they get what that is promised to them, are you going to play with their life, with their body, with everything? Like there are some people who believe that drugs send people to God. I mean, just imagine the absurdity of it. Now, thank God people know that drugs harm your attention, harm your awareness. There was a book written, I was told, I met somebody in Vancouver who's got a PhD by a book which was written about, I forgot the name of the gentleman, who has described that the alcohol takes you to spiritual life. Let's say absolutely. The thing that goes against your awareness itself, how can it take you to awareness which is enlightened? It would be something like to cover this light, break all the bulbs, everything, and that will take you to light. It is absolutely absurd. The whole statement is absurd. You cannot go to God if you try to harm your body, harm your mind, harm yourself. Even a person who has had a bad childhood, who is suffered because of something, say war or something, even such a person is little less blessed. In the beginning, we have to work on him to put his mind at rest, put his body at rest, to see that there is equilibrium within him, and then only you can get realization. Anybody who is a disturbed man, who is upset, we have to put it right. Now, some people have definitely felt that drugs are going to solve the problem. Honestly, they have felt it. I know they have been very honest about it. They have taken drugs, doesn't matter. That also can be neutralized because you are seekers. You have just done that because you are seeking. Is that the main thing? Is that you must see and that you must see? Is the main object of Sahaja Yoga that is you? So whatever may come, whatever may have happened, doesn't matter. It's going to be corrected. It's going to work out. And then overnight people give up because they realize that this is it. All problems of humanity are because we have not yet found out our spirit, which is the collective being. All international problems, all your political problems, all your economic problems come from that. One thing which has not happened to human beings, you are still in transition. I would say it would be something like people who are deep in the water, getting halfway up and halfway down. They don't know whether we are able to be saved or not. But once you have reached the shores, that's all right. That's a little breakthrough that has to take place, and people have to establish their collective consciousness. So there are many who get realization. You see, when you come here to get their realization, they disappear. That's it. They feel very happy, everything done now. Nothing. You have to become collectively conscious of it. Means you have to educate yourself to understand how to feel that collectivity within yourself. That is more important, more difficult for human beings. Because they are all like, a quick happening, a very quick happening. And the quick happening takes place, no doubt. But that quick happening is just taking you to a point where you have to stay, you have to be young. If becoming is a thing, like an egg breaks into a nice little bird, but the bird must learn to fly. If it does not educate itself to fly, it remains something in between egg and bird, and anybody can eat that off. It has no quality as a bird which can save itself, protect itself, and can fly and enjoy. It has no quality of a bird if it is just roaming about like cock and hen. You see, when they were in the forest, they used to fly. I've seen these forest ones flying very high. They can fly just like an eagle. But if you see them on the ground, if they are settled down on the ground, they are eaten up by people who can catch them. Anybody can catch them. So to have that quality, the quality of that collective being, one has to educate and rise above that shell system, that system that has bound them, that has made them an individual, which was important to have a shell for. The individuality was very, very important, otherwise it would not have been mature. So that a time comes that shell must be broken. Like, now, the car is important for me to bring down here, but I have to leave the car to come down inside. In the same way, you have reached a certain stage that up to that point it was all right, but you don't have to carry it on any further, and you have to settle down with a new dimension, a new life within you. And that's what is your second birth. For this, God has placed everything within ourselves. You see that a system did anything we come up with. You should have. Alright, doesn't matter. Now, you see, every time I don't want to put about Kundalini and all that, and there is a system within us called Kundalini. All is within. Now, it is very easy to sit down and say, now, no matter how you say it is. I mean, it's good, you see, because people want to know about it. How is it? You have the Kundalini in the triangular bone. And then we say that there are certain centers which look after, I mean, which manifest outside our growth centers, and all these things, we do talk about it. And but you can all doubt that thing. How can that be such a thing? How are you thinking? But why not? Because I'm not taking anybody from you. Nothing. By believing me, what is your loss? Nothing. Now the people who are here, you should see and ask them, their lives are all changed. They have become different people. They are enjoying themselves, they have got their own powers, they can manifest them, they have become experts, they look so simple, just like you. But if you see their faces, you see how blooming they are. Apart from that, that they know all about it. They are masters and scholars, and they are great gurus sitting down here around you. And you can also become that. So, there is nothing to doubt. But now, supposing you are a doubting Thomas, you see, if you will, I don't mind. If you doubt also, we try to solve the doubt. The main thing is of making you the spirit. That's our job. For that, we are here. And you are also for that. So it is better to cooperate with us than to argue and discuss and spoil everybody's attention. You see, some people are such reactionaries. They come, ask questions, and when it comes to realization, they just run out. Most people have seen such people who sit down with a very doubting mind all the time. But for what are you doubting? What are you going to lose? you have a cancer, you can be cured. If you have mental problems, they can be cured. All the problems can be cured as a blessing of God. It's true. And apart from that, you become your own power. But if it is a mass system, we don't love. You see, so for example, we go to church, we don't love. Just we don't love. We don't doubt the priest, we don't doubt anybody. We go to a temple, we never doubt the priest. We just pay as everybody pays. It's a mass system. It is not. Here, you are an individual. That's why you doubt. You are an individual now, and you doubt. But I would suggest that better to have your realization that waste your energy in doubting. Because if you are God's seeker, you are going to get your realization. It's not today, tomorrow. But only thing, why delay? Sooner, the better. But if you have any questions, I would like to answer them. We have all this Kundalini and all that, and I wish Kevin had told you about it, or somebody should have told you. Next time we have a lecture about Kundalini, what it is, how it is realization, how it rises, how it pierces through different chakras, pierces through your fertile bone area, and also how it gives you Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is what we call as the cool breeze in that, cool breeze of the Holy Ghost. And that's what you have to see. Now, if you have any questions, you may ask, because when you are getting realization, I want you to be free. Because you have to go beyond thought. And it just happens without any difficulty. There's nothing to worry. Now, there are people who say that Kundalini is very dangerous and all that. Maybe for people who do not know anything about it. Like if you put your hand inside this, you'll get a shock. Because they don't know what this means. But the one who knows the job. No, it's very simple. Even children can do it if they know it. If you have any questions, please ask. You should ask me some questions. How many of you have listened to the radio and have not? Anyone of you? It's good. Yes, it's good. So you thought it was very convincing what he said? Is it? Good. I'm happy. That's John. He's doing theology and he's outside of his mother's theology. He just talk. But he should have said one more point, as I said. John and Fagin, yeah? Fagin, he's there. Both of them had gone. But he didn't say that you get your own power. You see, in a cult, you do not get anybody's your power. You just like mad, all of you, walking into some sort of a blind alley. But you don't know where you are being. You must know what you are doing, what it is, everything about it. I am happy that you were so convinced by his listening. But we found it impossible to handle these people of the media. Very funny, actually. They don't want to, they are abhorred to, I think they are abhorred to, most surprising is that when you tell them the truth, they are really upset. They don't want to hear. See, you tell them some hanky-panky stories, they are very happy. They would like to tell you that there is a hanky-panky story behind it. But if you say, oh, you can get your realization, you are the truth, you are the spirit, they don't want to listen to you. They are very funny people, you know. They can't believe it. It can be. Why? Why shouldn't we have confidence in ourselves? After all, are we going to seek it again next year, why postpone it? If it is so, why not have it? This is the first time the radio people have allowed somebody to speak. While Sahaja Yoga has been growing very slow, intermedia help us, you see, understanding how important it is and vital that it should grow in these countries. Because in India it's much easier. Much easier. In thousands and thousands it's working out in the villages and all. But here, you see, media is so important and so powerful. Thank God we are not so developed. So we don't depend on media so much in India. And the newspaper people are also understand that truth has to be there. And they have helped us. They have been very helpful in India. Compared to here, nobody wants to even publish an article on Sahaja Yoga. Can you imagine? Nobody wants to know anything about it. Now, do you think?
And I was thinking, don't all the Sahaja Yogis use your photograph?
I'm a Sahaja Yogi?
Use your photograph.
When
they meditate.
Huh?
Your photograph.
Yes, now, I don't know who told you that. I say it should not be told, because see, people, they're frightened with the idea that why use my photograph? See, the problem is this. Now, see, the trouble is my photograph has got vibrations. Now, what will you do? Problem like that. It has tremendous vibrations. Not only when it can be open. There was a boy in America who was down with blood cancer. And that the parents of the boy came to see me in a very heartless village. And they wanted that the boy should be cured. So I don't know, I said, all right, we need a photograph, I'll work on it. But in any case, I sent them, asked them to telephone one of the surgeons in New York. She has only my photograph. And she used it, and the boy is cured. Now supposing it is so, say it's a penicillin injection, or you can call it something, you see, a miracle drug, for example, say my photograph is, then should we not use it? Now supposing it is. That's what it is. What can I do about it? I didn't know that the camera would be so good, really, I didn't know. Camera is much more sensitive than your computer. I must. You see, there are so many things that camera has caught up, which human beings cannot catch. Like one day I was sitting in a village, giving lecture, in a place where a real soul had died, a great real soul. And the camera caught, I mean, I can feel it, but you people do not see it with your eyes. A great flood of light was falling on my head. Flood of light. And the camera caught it, and six times it happened, and the camera caught it six times, and seven times it just went and it caught it. She said in the camera, I don't know if they have brought the photograph, but we have that photograph, and you can see it is there. Camera is so sensitive, and so honest, and so deep, that the way things have been shown by a camera. The other day, somebody took a photograph of my face in that instant camera. And both my feet, you see, I was telling them that these two centers are working very much. And they are on the feet, you see. And from my toe, you could see a shaft of light from one of the toes and one of the fingers, which I have said these centers are there. The camera. There must be something about me also, isn't it? It must be, of course. It's there. But it's better to see. And I always tell surgeons not to tell about the photographs just now to anyone. Because if you tell them, they get upset. You see, they think, oh God, she won't dominate me. You know, we are so frightened of domination, isn't it? Because people have been waiting to comment. But could be somebody loves you very much, that even a photograph of her can love you so much. Could be. Something we cannot think of someone who's just love. And the photograph has that love within itself. You can use it as you like. Then there should be no objection. None of the people before me were photographed. Christ was never photographed. Buddha was not photographed. Even Mohammed was not photographed. You see, the first time we have developed this wonderful thing called camera, and this is my photograph, what you do. In Hong Kong, the lady who was in charge, I mean Chinese are very wise people, and this lady who was in charge of that, how do you call it, TV center, she felt the vibrations and all that, and she said, Mother, why not we use you on the TV? I said, could I? And she put me there on the TV for about 3 minutes, just time. And she said, put your hands close to the photographer. And so many got good grades and they wrote to us, saying that we got good grades in our hands from others. And we have established a center in Hong Kong only by these things. If your TV people ever allow me to do that, I could help, you know, very greatly, isn't it? And would you not like to do it? I mean, supposing you were in my place, it would have been better, I know. But you cannot be. Anybody in my place can come and do it, I am very happy. But that's the trouble, you see. Christ has to bear the cross. He had to do it, nobody could do it. We don't mind him doing that. But why should we mind him being the Christ? So many are people. All right? Are you willing? No. Even you can give realization to people. You can give realization. All of them can give realization. They can cure. They are all experts sitting here, one better than the other. When you talk to them, it will be awake. They are all scholars. Somebody sitting next to you is quite good. Both sides, I should say. It is rather difficult to accept a photograph because it is said that you should not bow to any. It was said because there were no photographs before. Nothing was said. Photograph is such a simple thing. And you see yourself later on. Then you won't give up, I know that. You like it. Or any other question? A photograph, we also have symbolic value for photographs. Say, for example, we have the queen photographing. We'll not spit on her photograph, will you? She's not there. Will you spit on the photograph anyone of you? Will not. Because after all, that photo, that queen represents her, is a symbol. Isn't it? And you know, it may not be vibrations, but definitely, it is a symbol of something. It is the coefficients of the whole thing that works out there. Even when I'm talking to you, you'll be amazed. Something is working out for you. The sound also carries the vibration. You cannot think. But so many surgeons have seen the vibration going into it. You start seeing all these things. So you have to develop up to that point. Before that, we don't tell you anything about how to become collectively conscious in a permanent way. In the beginning we just say, alright, you let us give you the light. First you feel the light. Then you start seeing everything. Nothing is compulsory in Sahaja Yoga. But you yourself start to think because you know it is so. Should we have relaxation? Those who are new people should come forward. I would prefer it's better. If all on the second this thing. You all those who are realized should get up. These if you look at these people, they look just like you, isn't it? But they are all realized. They are all realized. This one is another expert. He used to sell wine before. Yes. It's true. Yes. They are all around you, in front of you, behind you. Can you come forward, please? Please. It's better. Here are some people want to come down. It's better to be in the front seat because later on, you see, if there is a problem with your Kundalini rise, why don't you come here, my chair? Come. You both of you come. If there's any problem, then the Sahaja Yogis can look after. They can raise the Kundalini with their own hands because the power is coming from their hands, you see. So they can raise the Kundalini and can give you realization. And then once you have got realization, you can give realization to others. It's as simple as that. Today they are realized folks, tomorrow you will be realized. All of you have to become realized folks. How many will become God alone knows, but there should be many. Even in the West, where things are moving rather slowly compared to India. But still, it will happen, I'm sure. Now for getting realization is a very simple method. It's that you have to expose yourself. Your fingers, see, these fingertips are the ends of all the sympathetic nervous system. And these two hands represent those seven centers, like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7. Seven centers are between the hands, exactly like that. You can even carry it later on. You can see. For example, if you have a liver trouble, you can feel them on your fingers. Everything you can feel on your fingertips. That's another, on my fingertips. That's how you become an expert. English language has very unconscious expression, which has shown that how you become realized. Now, so what happens that you just have to close your eyes. First of all, you must close your eyes. Because when Kundalini rises and pierces through this center of life, then there's dilatation of you. So we want your eyes to be closed at that time, so that Kundalini rises smoothly. And then she pierces out from here. When she pierces out from here, you can feel the cool breeze coming out of your head. You can feel it. But you have to have little melting of the sensitivity. You see, some people are not so sensitive and they do not feel it. It doesn't matter. If you don't feel it, today you feel it tomorrow. But most of them feel it, and these people, other surgeons, feel it. So we have to be wise, we have to be sensible about it, and it will work out. It will work out for all of you. It has to work out. You are seekers. This is your right to have it, and you are having it because it is your right. I'm just here like I tell all these people that I'm like a bank which is cashing your check. You have done good work in your last life and this life, and you are not wrongdoers. You are good people. You are seekers, and you are seekers of God of ancient times. You have come here to take your realization, you better get it. It's simple as that. My job is to give you realization. I am paid for it, you can think like that. And that is what it is, and you have to have it. There is no quality between you and me. If you don't want to have it, it's alright. But it is with me all the time, safe. Whenever you want, you can have it. But better to have it as soon as possible. Now put your hands towards me like this, and just close your eyes. Just put your eyes towards me. And you'll be amazed. The difference is just put both the hands towards me. I mean, it is a simple method. Why you are putting it? Because these centers must be exposed. It's important. Very simple. It is very simple method. Please close your eyes. Please close your eyes. Now there are problems within ourselves. They show up in our Kundalini rising. Not to you, but to the people who are sitting here, who are realized souls, and when you are realized souls, you will also feel it. At this time, the problem is on the heart. There is too much pressure on the heart. I would request all of you not to open your eyes, not to open your eyes, but put your right hand on your heart, inside your coat jacket. Just on the heart. There's pressure on your heart. And in the heart resides this pressure. Just put your left hand. And you can ask a question, a very fundamental question within your heart. You can ask me a question within your heart. Mother, am I the spirit? Just to ask that question. Because you are the spirit. But just ask that question. Ask that. Now, while talking to you about Sanjoga, I might have said something that might have upset you, or you might be thinking that I've done this wrong and that wrong. But forget the past. In Sanjoga, there's nothing like sin when you come from your realization. It's all washing. So don't worry about that, and don't feel guilty. If you feel guilty, of course there's a problem. But you just say within yourself, in your heart, that, Mother, I'm not guilty. You are not guilty at all anymore now. anything that you think is very wrong, forget for the time. Just forget and say, hi, mother, I am not guilty. Now the third thing you have to ask is to say, mother, am I my own master? Am I my own guru? Also ask this question 3 times. Please put both the feet on the ground in a straight way. You see, with the mother earth helps us like that. Now you may ask the question again, saying, mother, am I the part and parcel of the whole? Please don't feel guilty. Please don't feel guilty. Please don't feel guilty. It's a passion at feeling guilty. It's a competition. Who feels more guilty? People like to have some sort of big tragedies artificially built around their lives. Please ask the question, am I part and parcel of the whole? Just ask the question, please. Because collectivity comes to people who are large-hearted, who are big-hearted, big people, who are not small. Now please put both the hands closed. Both the hands. And just say, mother, I've forgiven all the people. I've forgiven everyone. Please put both the hands closed. And just forgive him. Forgive him. Say, I've forgiven him. Mother, I've forgiven him. Forgive. Now, you have to say this because I cannot go against your freedom. You are free to choose. So you have to say, Mother, may I have my realization? Will you please give me realization? Because I cannot force it upon you. You have to ask. It's your freedom. Just ask for it.